I want to use for a subject today, One Nation Under God. And for a text, we turn to the Old Testament, Psalm 33. I'll begin reading with verse 8. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spake, and it was done. He commanded, and it stood fast. The Lord bringeth counsel of the heathen to naught. He maketh the devices of people of none effect. The counsel of the Lord standeth forever. The thoughts of his heart to all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he hath chosen for his own inheritance. And then from the New Testament, we turn to our Lord's Gospel according to Matthew, 14th chapter, verse 22 and 23. And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. One of the dominant themes in our day is how to change the appalling ambiguities and paradoxes that we face. On one hand, we have abundant wealth. On the other hand, we have abject poverty. We are better educated today than we have ever been. And yet, the employment lines are full. And then we live in better houses than we ever lived in our lives. But our homes are falling apart. We're all dressed up. We are vogue on the outside and vague on the inside. There was a time when I could eat anything that I got my hands on, but I couldn't get my hands on much. Now I'm able to buy anything I want to eat, and the doctors tell me, no, you can't have that. We live in the best of times and the worst of times. We live in a day when every thinking person ought to give glory to God. We thank him for this meeting here today. This is a great day to be alive and a great day to serve the Lord. Yet, as we meet here, we are aware that we are meeting against the backdrop of mounting world tension. This hate-filled world is desperate for a decent way of life. It sees astounding world events tumbling over each other in rapid succession, rushing on to ruin. Civilization is toying with degradation and flirting with doom and disaster. High-mindedness runs the streets like a mad dog, beating an uncertain path. Selfishness has evaporated the milk of human kindness, and pain and panic are chasing each other like June bugs playing in the summer sun. Paradise has been turned into pandemonium. Puny men are still piddling around with passing days. Under the magic of science, distance has disappeared. We no longer measure distance by the miles, but by the hours. Los Angeles is 10 hours from London. Now that simply says that isolationism is dead and buried without the slightest hope of a resurrection. Whether you realize it or not, we are interdependent and we are interrelated. We cannot live without each other, and we have not learned to live with each other. And unless we learn to live with each other, it is doubtful that we shall live at all. We are one nation under God. And blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Even when we rejoice in that fact, we're worried about our economy. And the Lord has a word to say about the economy even in this day. In this text, Jesus had just fed a multitude. Yes, he had finished speaking, and the disciples went to him and said, "Send these people away. Let them go into the village and buy food." Jesus said to them, "No, don't send them away. You feed them." And then they began to check their economy. The statistician, the mathematician, figured up how much bread it would take to feed that multitude. And they came back complaining to Jesus about the economy. "We're just not able to provide food for all of these people, yet you tell us to feed." And Jesus said, "Bring me what you have." You remember, they brought him a lad who had 5 loaves and 2 fishes. May I hasten to tell you, Jesus is the only one who can multiply 5 times 2 and get 5,000. For when he got through multiplying the fish and the bread, he fed 5,000 men beside women and children. He had to teach them that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And then when you feed people, they will want to make a king out of it. That multitude wanted to make a king out of Jesus. Even the disciples were taken in with that idea. And the Lord had to teach them something about politics. Had to teach them that you don't make me king. I'm already king. They saw no necessity of prayer. Jesus told them, "Get into the ship and go before me to the other side." And when Jesus had dismissed the crowd, he went up into a mountain apart to pray, and he was there alone. It's obvious, if Jesus had to pray, what about you and me? While he was up in the mountain praying, the disciples were out there in the ship, a ship that they owned. Not many men in that day owned a ship. Jesus didn't even own a boat. But these were affluent men. And Jesus told them to get into the ship and go to the other side. Not only did they own that ship, but they knew how to handle it. They were good sailors. They were used to sailing the sea. They were there, out there on the sea, and all of a sudden, a storm struck. Isn't that just like some experiences we go through in life? When things are going well, all of a sudden, trouble arrived. There these men, I'm talking about affluent men, well-trained men. They were there in the ship, and when that storm struck, the wind began to blow, waves got contrary. There they were, caught in a situation that they couldn't handle. Now, they had been accustomed to sailing the seas before. They had been in storms before, but nothing like this. They struggled with all of their strength to try to bring stabilization to that ship. But the Lord allowed them to work and work. And let me tell you, whenever Jesus Christ is out of the picture of your life, you can work your head off and still get nowhere. These men rowed, and they tried with all of their might, but to no avail. And they reached the point of panic. Let me tell you, when you reach the point of panic, that's 1 part guilt and 2 parts doubt. Right at that time, Jesus had to let them know that without me, you can do nothing. No matter if you are afloat, no matter if you are experienced at sailing the seas, without me, you can do nothing. Just at that time when they were about to reach the point of panic, Jesus came to them walking on the sea. And isn't that just like Jesus? Just when I need him, Jesus is near. Just when I falter, just when I fear. Ready to help me, ready to cheer, just when I need him most. Jesus came to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him, they got afraid. And they cried out for fear. It's a ghost, it's a spirit. It seems to me that if you've ever seen the Lord, you would never forget him. But the disciples have forgotten about him. There they saw him walking on the sea and they didn't even know who he was, calling him a spirit. Then Jesus uttered his voice and said, "Be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid." Isn't that comforting? Be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. And then the spokesman for the crowd, Simon Peter, I'm talking about that reckless one, that big mouth one, the one who is always showing off, and the one who always leaps before he looks. But that's still better wisdom than a man looking so long he never leaps. Simon Peter exclaimed, "Lord, if it be thou." Now he's all mixed up. He's all confused. The Lord, he had just seen the Lord. He had heard him speak. He had heard him identify himself. "It is I, be not afraid." And yet, he comes back saying, "Lord, if it be thou." The Lord had told him, "It is I. But if it be thou, bid me come to thee on the water." Peter had forgotten his prayer. The Lord taught us to pray in the plural. Whatever you pray, for yourself, pray for your neighbor. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. But no, Peter is praying prayer that is filled with pride. His pride made him say to himself, "Jesus can walk around on the water in the dark. I can do it. I want to do it." That's the reason he blurted out and said, "Lord, bid me come to thee. Forget about these other fellows. Just let me do it." He wanted to outdo and outdare the other disciples. And that old spirit is among us today. We want to outdo and outdare everybody else. But one thing I have to give Peter credit for. He didn't get out of that ship to walk the water until Jesus told him. There are a lot of us out here trying to walk the water and the Lord hasn't told us. When Jesus said, "Come," I can see Peter getting out of that boat, getting out of that ship, stepped on the water, and the Bible says that he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Now give him credit again. He might not have walked far, but he walked further than anybody else. He walked on the water to go to Jesus and was out there doing fine. But the Bible says, but when he saw the winds boisterous, he became afraid and beginning to sink. Let me tell you, when you take your eyes off of Jesus, you're going to sink. It doesn't matter how well trained you are. When you take your eyes off of Jesus, you're going to sink. Peter found himself sinking, and I give him credit again. He knew whom to call. He didn't call headquarters. He didn't call for some of the other disciples, Philip, Bartholomew, but he said, Lord, and give him credit again. Now he knows how to pray. He didn't stand there, strike up a pole. O thou who art omnipotent, thy wisdom excites our imagination, and your omnipotence turns every spot on earth to holy ground. He didn't go through all of that. He just said, Lord, save me. And isn't that just like Jesus? When we have ruined our lives, when we've messed up our lives, when we've gone contrary to his will, when we have forgotten about his power, his promises, and go to concentrating on our problems, even then, if you call him, he will answer. The Bible says, immediately, Jesus stretched forth his hand, brought Simon Peter up and put him back in the boat. Now you notice, the storm is still raging. A lot of times the Lord has to calm us before he calms the storm. He calmed Peter. He said, O thou of little faith, why did you doubt me? You have seen me dispel demons. Why did you doubt me? You've seen me break the bonds of those who are bound. Why did you doubt me? You've seen me still a storm before. Why did you doubt me? You've seen me furnish food for the famishing. Why did you doubt me? You've seen me lavish my love on the least, the lone, and the lost. Why did you doubt me? You've seen me confer comfort on the bereaved. Why did you doubt me? You've seen me reconcile ruptured relationships. Why did you doubt me? Didn't you believe me when I said, I am your God? Be not dismayed. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with the right hand of my majesty. Didn't you believe me? Why did you doubt me? I'm saying to America today, in the midst of all of our conflict and crisis, don't doubt the Lord. In this upturned economy, don't you doubt the Lord. Doesn't matter about how crooked politics gets, don't you doubt the Lord. And it doesn't matter about the storms of life, don't doubt the Lord. It doesn't matter what unfortunate set of circumstances might surround you. Don't you doubt the Lord. You can trust him. He is able, and the only one able, to satisfy every need according to his own riches and glory. He can take care of all of our needs, and he does it simultaneously. He supplies strength for the weak. There's no energy shortage with him. Things don't run out on him. The resources, the reservoir of resources never recedes. The wisdom of his word never wanes. The vigor of his virtue never fails. The burnish of his beauty never blemishes. The lust of his love never lessens. The prowess of his power never perishes, and the fountain of his fullness never fails.